047, the last three. Okay, our next speaker, Robert Kryder. He's currently living in New Mexico. He has spent most of his life in the southwest region of the country as an inventor, explorer, specializing in professional research. Mr. Kryder founded Kryder Exploration in 1994, and he and his team have worked as advocates to create USFS treasure hunting permits, as well as to utilize some of the most infamous treasure sites and even crime scenes in the USA. He also specializes in various technology like subsurface imaging with his services. His ability and methods of approach have made him a valued resource for universities and academics working on French sciences. Eventually cooperating on Bigfoot field research and studies at the request of the Oxford University in London and the Museum of Zoology in Switzerland and the University of New Mexico, Gallup, New Mexico. Mr. Kryder has been featured on various networks and syndicate broadcasts, TV, radio shows, and podcasts, including Art Bell's Midnight in the Desert, Untold Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles, Jerry and Kathy Willis, Nightcrawler, Caller Radio, WBR, Crypto Reality, and many, many others. He has presented to scientific peer groups and academic professionals, as well as public Bigfoot conferences. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Robert Kryder.
First off, I want to say thank you very much for showing up here at Kiamichi Mountains Bigfoot Conference. It is a great crowd. I've actually had a lot of compliments from you, from our other speakers and vendors both. And, you know, thanks for the appreciation of Tommy Kornick. Her and I coordinated this event, and I'm proud to do so. And you guys are representatives of the best group I've ever seen in life. So thank you very much. As John said, my name is Robert. I'm founded in 1994, a research and recovery and excavation company. And in that, I was not primarily a Bigfoot researcher. And I didn't get into that until 2010 as a focal point for some of my work. So I often tell people this is about 2% of what we do. And in a way, it runs together. So there's a lot of cross and moving into forth. So doing professional research and recovery operations for about 30 years. And in those, I worked with, you know, just about everybody on the backside. Everything from government agencies to private individuals to consortiums of wealthy people who are just looking for value. And throughout that, I gained a lot of technical ability and understanding and ability to research and the methodology that it took to recover treasures and things that have been hidden for 1,000, 3,000 years. And a lot of that involved decoding, you know, pretty complex code systems. And to do that, you've got to look back through history and see where it came from. And the reason I get into that, even with this conversation, is that that's the same methodology that's applied to the Bigfoot question. Now, the reason that I actually started to drop information, and not just personal experience, but years, because we weren't looking for Bigfoot throughout the things we did, but often in the areas where things are concealed, it's going to be the most rugged and most remote haunted, or whatever they can say. It's not anything they can do to keep you out of the specific zone. These are also the zones that are often occupied by creatures that don't have room or space or have been pushed into the limits of the habitat. So this is where these things are. And it's not a coincidence when people tell that inspire stories of places like the Haunted Mesa or the Haunted Canyon or some other thing like that. It's an experience that your gut feels gives you, like a genetic fear, it's true. Now, it's the same thing on treasure sites. Ancient history or recovery. You learn to deal with these things in professional operation, partly so you can understand what's going on, but as well, so you don't have that fear response that often happens. Even now, I'm more anxious than the moments when they occur. So, what we lived through here is a development to where, as I gained understanding by being around these things on a deep operation, I just a truth was self evident. Or truth that is evident all the time. This goes from the behavior of the species as well as what we see around us and how they interact with us. And the behavior of our operation on deep treasure sites, you often have a lot of other interests. It may be a foe, rival, paramilitary group who wants to try to flashback your project. It may be spiritual or some type of operation that makes everyone on your whole site is going to shut down. So dealing with these adverse conditions, being able to hang, this is the things that enable me to get into a deeper understanding of them when they encounter God. And as well as so many people, the strength that I have those moments were because I had teams and networks beneath me. So my world is a lot different than the Bigfoot world is developing than it's seen. In 2010, with the advent of better videos on YouTube than more going out there, I did. But what I saw was things like, you might have seen him, famous by now, like Billy Kidd. Just a moment, sir. If you guys have any questions for the end of the comment,
I can't hear you.
Oh, you can't hear me? Okay. I'll talk to that thing.
There you go.
Okay, sorry about that.
Come forward.
So as well, sorry, I'm going to use my train of thought here. As we went through the years with the Bigfoot question, and we started to develop, what I saw was, the guy named Billy. I don't think I remember this guy, but I mean, it was Bigfoot, great head and things, and kind of intriguing pictures, yet it would be a Bigfoot eating an ice cream cone on a quad, let's say, or something like this. And when I got to start actually looking for the room, in 95, we filmed a very big rail. It was about a half mile, but we had the highest tech rail at the time, which is 120 zoom, 12 power over 10 optical, with an enhancing JVC experimental camera. And we were able to enhance that backtrack with the snap and stop, whatever the CIA reclassified stuff. In 92, we acquired that, so by 94, I was already good at using it. And we broke that down, and we could see an actual Bigfoot on a ridge and see anatomical features that showed up as a male, things like this. So I have this already. It's never popped. So in 2010, like I said, I just got frustrated. So I decided, heck with it, I'm going to release it. And so we started. And then at the same time, it just so happened around that period that where we lived locally, someone had a slight encounter with something. And that's something that was obvious to me, what was, because the tendency for a game to move in one direction, to a higher baby direction, without apparent stop motion, which is very difficult to do. And then the guy said, yeah, it looked like a clown. So it was so fluid, his arms waved. He said, I got a loose cell phone picture of it. It's blurry because it was moving. And so I looked at it. Sure enough, that's what it was. And so it just happened to be moved out into this area. Into a place where there was a large canyon, the highway, where people used to just dump their food over the porch. And there was a bunch of bachelors, cowboy stuff. And when they were done, they just tossed them like they would eat. So when we got in there, we weren't doing anything. Then we started getting bedding on the house. And then the stables were broken into where the feed room was. And then something was taken, oats out of the feed cup that lay in the lid back there. And so you can look in the dust and start to see marks. Oh my gosh, we have one visiting from this place. And so just have to live with it. So we, that went back and forth for a while. So I went ahead and we just started to say, screw it all, just apply everything we've got, technique, tools, and even our contacts into finding out and putting some decent material out there and doing that specific approach. So as we did that, we learned a lot through the years. A lot of people there had no clue what they were encountering. They didn't come to us, so we realized there was a family unit on a local river system. That's a riparian zone, meaning it's different than the surrounding habitat or environment. So you have a high desert region with broad open grasslands and things, and then you have sparse cedar groves, and then you go up. These elevation changes are quite dramatic, but they're sparse, 40, 50 miles between them. And when you go up those, they're heavy pine trees. Different, totally different environment. So what you end up with is a cell. So in the very river bottom, you might have anywhere 500 to 2,500 feet wide along the river system of foliage and good riparian. And in that, in this particular one, there's 285 species of vertebrates occupied that small zone. So it's high density aligned, everything's transient up and down in quick motion, basically, following the resources. And we realized that there was a family unit in there. And we did this by recording. So I built a very high-end sound recording equipment. And this time we had a 36-inch dish, which was made out of a kid's snow split. And it was still using half focus to that, 22 feet off our mobile lab. And we recorded things that was unheard of. And I'll be playing some of those for you tomorrow. And we realized what was going on. There was an entire dynamic that we could see through sound. So just as people see through a camera, you can see through sound. that stuff was done a bit cheap, so we were able to focus and track progress of individuals. And they were under finer tracks, find who led, who told who was, how the exchange was occurring. And so you'll hear vocal exchanges independent of unity, and you'll hear some of the things like when you're audio fit. What it gets to is eventually, because we were doing analytical work, I was approached by Oxford University. I was also involved with J.C. Johnson, C4C, up in the Four Corners region, and back and forth. And so this all goes kind of around the corner, actually. So you can think vicariously, we worked with J.C. a little bit on the backside, a consultation where you get information with the Arabs and stuff, but not directly. And then when it came time to Oxford University, the Brian Sykes, they requested our participation. So we donated a sample that we already had. And the SCAT sample that's on our table came from this, it actually came from that SCAT sample. And it was deposited on the outside of it, no fiber hair inside. And the reason was that came from a 10,000 foot in December, with 3 feet of snow that had frozen, even in the city. You're talking very, very cold conditions for a long period of time. And so, and it's also hollow shaft, it's chestnut brown. It's on that material, that scat represents this one quarter of its diameter. So it's about 2 1/4, a little less than half of its diameter. And it's all pinyon pine shell fragments. So people don't eat pinyon pine shell fragments. And for bear to do that, it'd be very, very difficult. You can just get those and not get all kinds of other stuff, pine needles and whatnot. Nothing else is there. What was more important, there was a large structure, and it obviously caught snow. It was a great place, and then it was big though. And there was tracks that had been filled. It was over snow, and then there was a place where the snow had been moved, and obviously it's like pinyon. And the defecation sample was probably 18 inches long by that diameter. So what we figured is it was 10 to 15 pounds minimum of pinyon shells and off. So nothing can do that. It was with the altitude. So we took that sample and we sent it to Oxford. They sent us back quick results. And they said that it came from an unknown species. There was no recoverable DNA because the hair shaft was broken. But it didn't come from it. So when I say that, what I mean is no sample should be tested in a study like that that's known. Okay, so they know what everything is. When you put in a bear, I think it's a bear. Shows up as a bear pair, period. A primate shows up as a primate. These things are easily identifiable, and they say by secondary biology students and already have this ability to do these hairs. Now, these laboratories that we're talking about is the Museum of Zoology in Switzerland, and this is the best in the world at zoological studies. So what we get is this letter back, and then they request, can you get us another specimen, perhaps up a little bit, another sample, perhaps up a little bit specimen. So I agreed to take that up. So it did take us a while. It's not an easy task to do. They wanted a hydrated pollen. So that's within 15 to 45 minutes out of the air. So we did that, but it took 2 months. And you'll notice if you go back through the site study, they held that study for 2 months before they did. That was to get the sample. Now I say this, and I'll go over it in the end of my deal, right? I'll just quickly summarize. I'll begin with this by saying that it culminated in basically lies to the Associated Press about the end sum of this work. Now, to just go by this and get into the presentation, I will touch back and close that. Eventually, we worked with the University of New Mexico to do a year-long study. And this one was jumped as well. So in the end zone, again, right inside, but on a whole new level. And what we presented during that year was the understanding of the ecology and behavior of the species. And we presented that to the university. And it was an amazing tournament up there. It was just really amazing. This is the highest university we had in 47-year history. So we opened it to the public, and it was to the faculty and other peers and professors. So what I'm going to show you now is a quick summarization of that understanding that we gained and that information. And I want to start this with a quote by Sir Conan Doyle. When you're doing anything possible, whatever, however improbable, must be true. So, this is part of a scientific understanding, except in today, because it eliminates all the flamboyant, also things that you stray from whatever's left. So, this is what we determine using this methodology. We're going to start with the ecology, diet, and acquisition. Now, one of the things we've seen is year long, as anyone knows, any type of hominid or hominid has to have some form of green vegetation. Or another. That's all part of the way it works. We found these sources even in the wintertime to be certain leafy greens, algae. People don't think of algae as a food source. It's everywhere. And it's also one of the best foods you can eat, period. And it has a way of surviving even under ice and some conditions. Naturally, regionally, these creatures are going to understand. And I don't mean to say creatures in any mean fashion because I believe there are people. But these creatures understand, of course, how to utilize resources in their natural environment. And this is a big one. When we see them not be able to acquire food for periods of time, they'll often result in algae and sand, to where when they pass it, they pass green sand as their scat. And you can see if you were living out there, it hurts and you can't run around with it if you stop. So often animals will consume anything they can. And this is another thing that validates partially to us by process of elimination and applied logic of what in the world just eats sand and algae. There's just what is out there that will do that. Now, one of the main food sources we notice in our area, so you have to have have something to subside on when there's no hunting, there's no game, something's scared the meat away. This is not producing, that's not producing. Something needs to be an environment to raise a family group. And in this case, that something is Russian olive, which provides sustenance year round. Because when everything is prolific, this is their staple, they don't really collect it. And it's everywhere on the ground, and it's in thickets that have thorns 2 inches long that also make great coverage. And they build tunnels through this stuff because it's hard to access through it. So they make passageways and they actually make cells. When you get into these, they're cleaned out on the inside. There's not even a twig in the ones they use. Sometimes they're quite large. Other times the cells maybe 3.5-4 feet tall, 5 feet wide, as far as the tunnels between each cell. So this is something that they develop for shelter, for cover, as well as it provides them hunting opportunities too, because as other animals move through there, it's all cordoned off. They know how to make lock at certain locations so they feel safe. They always do themselves a rear exit to get out of any particular spot they're in. So Russian olive has been what we found as a substance food source because it's readily available. So any other site that you guys are at, it might be reeds. Reeds are another high nutrition product that grows all over the place that they can transfer and move location based on where the reeds are. So they can move these food zones up and down the river system thanks to the conduit over great distances because they've got to have that constant food. Now, a family unit isn't going to probably travel that far. We'll discuss that. Pinyon pine nuts. We just talked about the defecation over there on the table. That scat material, pinyon pine nuts. And in a lot of regions, these things grow as the elevation changes. So scat found in different regions tells us where they've been. So if you're in a valley where there's no pinyon pine, if the scat you're finding is has Bigfoot sign there as well, and it has pinyon pine remnants in it, it tells you where the subject went. So we also do that with domestic bird seed, things like that. We try to figure out who's wearing what bird seed mixes, because then we bird seeders, and then we can figure that out. Juniper berries. This is an astringent berry. They distill these things to make gins. They're also called ginberry. But they're very astringent. They're very difficult to eat. And we find these periodically in the scat as well, but not in high volume. And it's either sometimes people think because they've been used medicinally, or stomach treatment ailments, maybe stomach parasites, things like that, and it often it's considered maybe they're doing this to treat something. Yucca stem and base root. So this is something that most people don't consider. And this photo in particular is going to reflect on Mitchell Downing's presentation on teak thimbrin. So again, this, there's no known species that does this to a yucca. There's no food source of a yucca. Even bear don't eat yucca. might eat like a fruit, and sometimes they'll dig the root up and munch that, but never this. So this is when you pull the entire plant in, as you can see on the lower left here. And on the right side, if you look closely, you'll see the teeth imprints across the yucca. Now, one thing the yucca is good for is making high tactile rope, because the fiber is so really tough. You can't bite through that. You can bite off and scrape the soft inner end, but he's bitten so far up there, he's up into this real fibrous, rough, this husk and rind, which is something that just the people, if you do it, you'd be gnawing the meat. It's worse than hemp rope. So, and you can see here, now, there was probably an area, there's not much on the bottom of that, but it also represents moisture. As a survival tactic in areas where you have this growth or Spanish bayonet and other plants like that, you pop the bottoms and you take that bottom in because it's more moisture. So what we found is there was an area here probably a quarter of a mile by a half mile where all the yucca had been torn out like this, and all of them had their bottoms bit off. So it was a considerable effort to do that. So there was also a lot of marking, but it had been a while, as you can see. So there was a lot of marks on the ground. Birds are a huge food source, we've seen. And it's usually nesting birds that nest in areas they can get their hands on. Woodpeckers prolific. And you'll see if there's low woodpecker population somewhere, there's a high chance of Bigfoot activity. And I say that because they're easy to get. At dusk, if you watch where a woodpecker goes, it goes into a hole. All you need to do is cover the hole, and they pull the whole side of the tree out and pick the bird up. And then it's funny though, because in almost every case, and they're almost anal about it, that it tells you something about their behavior. And I know Webb will probably ingest this, is that they put all the feathers in a small pile. And they almost always do this. They don't like look around this, throw them over here. No, they're always piled in a little bitty pile. And they're very neat. And you never find any other piece of bird. Beep, nothing. So it's kind of like they're, you know, it's a little treat they're about to munch, and they carefully pluck the whole thing and put it in another pile. But it tells you a lot about their psychology, not just what they're eating. So birds are indicative of a behavioral pattern across the board. Now, you might be surprised on this one. This tells you the diversity of your diet. When you want to eat, you eat. In this case, the subject passed a set of porcupine quills. There's a few animals that learn how to prey on porcupines, but the southern porcupine that we have out there is not a nice little creature. He doesn't have little bitty spines, and they're actually pretty aggressive because they've got to do to survive. To consume a porcupine would not normally mean consuming spines and skin with just about anything. And whatever this was, which actually, it was deposited at a time of the year where the ground was frozen. When we went in there at 5:30 or 6 in the morning, but by 8 o'clock it already started to thaw, so there was no prints from that night. But there was pretty good scats on it, and a few different subjects there. But this one really taught us what the limits were, the potential limits of the diet. Here now, again, this reflects on the hominology of the creature. So we have a hominin for sure, of some type or another. It's not just in one food case that we find this bite imprint signature. It's in many we find. I found hundreds of examples, and I get chastised all the time because I run boxes of them in the closet. But I'm quite confident that anytime we wanted to go out and get more, we can do that very quickly. This happens to be one we collected on a recent lodge expedition at the end of the last day when I was coming down the trail. And this bone in particular is still fresh. It still had moisture, not just in the bone, but the meat itself was still slightly pliable and meaty. So it couldn't have been out there more than 2 days in that environment to be like that. And it hadn't been removed fresh. And it was interesting to me because you can see how delicate the socket is there, the edge of that socket. And there's not a single canine mark whatsoever. Now, bear, and also I'll add to this, it was on a trail, like you're walking and tossed your gum wrapper on a trail, right, with no sign of hesitation from any animal, certainly no hoof mark or anything, from anything, even deer, a pack of bones to carry around, some calcium, but nothing like that occurred here. And as well as too big for what we do, a little bird, a crow to pick up, but there was no other bone. I mean, there was not my visual line of sight, and four up and down the trail, not another single bone, which if it had come downhill from the natural kill that got broken apart, for one, it should have been older than that if it got separated from the body that long, and two, if it had done that, it would have just had more sign up too. Or down. So it did, and then what that tells me, it's transported there. And then we look at the only evidence of picking it up and moving it would be what appears to be large common bike park. Then the cartilage section and the fin section off the end of the bomb, which is also something that's commonly done if creatures can do that, because that's where you have leaders for your introit and a bunch of other stuff. So it's a softer part of the bone. We all have a lot of people like that too. This is another bone. It shows the other side of the diet, which would be domestic livestock. People think, well, do they kick out? Sure, they kick out, but probably, gets into the behavior aspect again, which we'll get to a little bit here in a minute. But it's not as frequent, I would say, but they certainly do. And they tend to deposit them somewhere out of the way. Now, to me, that's also indicative of either wanting to hide while you consume and a habit of doing it in the same place, or I really don't want everyone seeing them. I just whack the cow. So it's odd. And the reason we say is they often, when they're deposited like this, or it's one bone, period, corner, whatever, it's there, nothing else, or they've removed it at some point. But in this case, as you can see, there's, again, hominid teeth scrapes there in the bones that are clear and evident, and they're a half inch wide. So they were just as wide as my thumbnail, which is a little over half. So, and again, with Mitchell Townsend to compliment his presentation, this is twice the size of the average person. It's just right at twice the size. And this is the exact same. Now, there's not another species out there. Even the canines or the scissor teeth of the Edmo bear, or wolf, or anything like that, or even cat, don't leave anything like that mark. The marks, it's like a nice fashioned thumbnail. Not quite that round as most people's, and then just a perfect dig. Where it was an effortless, a lot of pressure went through there to do this and not follow the contour of the bone, but in spite of the bone. So, now here's again, stuff that's common. Grubbing logs. Grubbing logs, we see bear do it, we see things that people just blow it off right away because they know that bear does that. It's funny though, because if you look at the damage in this log, where the log's pretty high, that's a tall log. I mean, it's this big. So where's all the damage at? It's all in the top of the log. The pieces are not torn down and out. They're ripped off and dropped. And it was interesting because one of the pieces is actually behind the bow is laying on the log. Like it's moved to the side on the log. The bear's gonna rip into that log too. But the bear's gonna do sweeping motions, all the log open, they'll use their mouth too, just like a dog or anything else, and they'll blow at it. But it's an absolute different damage than what you're going to find. And they dig in the wood to get the things out. These lift the parts out, and they're digging needles and stuff out of the hole without doing all that other digging damage through the material. So they're getting the actual grubs. This time of year, they're picking grubs. So it was like a bear, but it was absolutely unlike a bear in the same note. This takes us to another method. Digging the sticks is something that we say, oh, that's tool use, that's cool. Well, we know that, there are birds that use tool, that's proven. All kinds of creatures use tool. It's not something that's not common in the animal kingdom. We should absolutely expect anything that has the trace behavior and morphology of the animal we're looking at, we should expect them to use. In this case, this is one that condition occurred. So in the lower left, you'll see the hole marked in circled in yellow, and then you'll see the stick that lays lower left of that. Now that tool is the tool used to excavate out a rat or whatever's in the stem, most likely a rat outside in a hole term. Now, and we know that because the end of the stick had obviously been used for the dig. It gets worn down with dirt packed in the end. We didn't see any artificial sharpening or anything like that to it. But what we look at on the right side is the marks from the stick. So claw marks are a lot of animal mark digging is a lot different than this. You have tons of series of crossing from claws, whether it be a wolf, a badger, whatever, they'll cross and they'll do this. There'll be a lot of them. In this, we don't see that. We see where something has scooped down the whole section over and over and over in a very repetitive fashion. That tells you again something about the mental aspect or the way the behavior of the methodology of the animal is doing something. It's not just pawing at it trying to get to something, it's doing something particular to get there. so this is something else that they can do, what people don't see. Now, we often either envision this, have witnessed this, or even like myself, have been a victim of this, but rock throws as a hunting technique. So we noticed that I've been hit, and it was a high accuracy situation, very high accuracy, and it was done from a position that we all know as spider crawling. And it was a pretty large individual, but I wouldn't say it was a very old individual. As a matter of fact, represented with the other members of the family unit that were surrounding us, is definitely not very old, and it was the furthest away at 60 feet. And it threw a rock at a sidearm, and you guys can go on our web channel and see that, and here's some information. But hit it sidearm and hit me, both of us, with the rock. It grazed this guy's belly and then hit me in gloves and a jacket, and it messed us up pretty good. And so we can suppose, and with great confidence, that rock throwing is a hunting method because they're accurate. Now, when we see debris like this, where there's tons of fresh leaf material drop, there's both green foliage and everything else, and there's a rock laying there in its condition where you know no other human has been, at least in time it would be throwing a rock on top of this. So this had happened within a day, let's say, because if you lay that rock there, take it up, there's an imprint, do it on your lawn or anything else, the vegetation is infected. We pick this up, it looks totally fresh, like somebody just threw this rock. This rock is probably a pound and a half to 2 pounds. At 50, 60 miles an hour, that's enough to take a deer out. If you're accurate, that's plenty to wipe out an animal. You're crushing rib cage, you can take a skull out. So it's quite effective. Now, we're going to look at large rocks for large deer. This is one where we actually got the 20, what would be closed, it's 19 inch showing, it's a 22 inch overall track. This subject apparently is an older subject. You can almost tell because he's very depleted. He has a thin section to his body. You can see he's not very heavy, meaty-wise. He's a thin guy. But at the same time, we find bite imprints with missing teeth, which both of these are indicative of older great age. So in this case, we tracked him down to a region where he apparently was standing on the ground in quad mode, and he had both his hands flat. The handprints are 16 inches long, 15 inches wide. And he was on all fours, and there was two smaller subjects walking, not running, down a hill, and there was one deer, apparently, in front of them, came down, and it turned right in front of him. Then this rock was in that position, but not naturally. We could not figure out where that rock was collected from, and that's about 110-pound chunk of granite. And whatever it was, and apparently thrown that granite at that deer, because you can see the deer kick out marks with the feet, and then bushes were stacked, and there was no more deer anywhere. And then his prints went farther downhill. So it was the story that the evidence was trying to say was two smaller individuals were working a deer down the hill to a waiting older large male or a little large subject who then used a 110-pound chunk of granite to take out a deer. It's very, very telling that we don't need to suppose much, but if we look at the evidence laid before us as a whole in context, this is what the story is. So that takes us on the tracks. Everybody likes tracks. There's a lot of kind of tracks. There's all kinds. You look at animals, and there's so many minute variations between creatures, it's insane. Of course, many look completely different, and many look forward, we wouldn't even understand it was tracks. So I'm sure there's a couple of shapes on the screen. You can look at those and you recognize this, and that's on the far right. Everyone knows what their hand and foot looks like. But do we consider what the hand and foot look like when they're in different positions, or maybe different overall physical positions on the ground, or interacting with a specific type of environment, be it sand, blood, or whatever? And often people don't consider that when they're looking for traces of these animals. They're looking for hand and feet. Things that look like hand and feet. I'll just tell you from experience, in a family unit, almost everybody's quad all day. They're not moving somewhere. You get an adolescent, or you get the young, you get the hunters, and you get things like that who move up and down a system or throughout a territory, and they're full biped. They're moving. And oftentimes they're stalking it, apparently on 2 feet even. But most often when they're in sedentary, like a family group does, and they're hanging out, you know, they'll hang out. I don't want to get into that a little too briefly, but the way they are, they're often in positions and interacting with their environment in ways we don't think they're going to. So they contact the ground with elbow, knee, fingers, toes, and things that just move around all the time throughout this stuff. And then we would walk through this and never notice anything that looks remotely like a bighorn tractor. When we say the infamous spider crawl thing, that's on their fingertips when we witness that. They're using their fingers because they're apparently more agile than their hand. So I don't mean running on their fingertips. I mean there's arm movement, but their ability to move with a finger down instead of a palm down is pretty unbelievable, even just a couple of fingers. And so that's what we see here. So on the graph on top, these are different positions of a hand. If you put your bodies in different positions and try to be on the floor. Now tomorrow I'm going to do a little tracking workshop, and we're going to kind of demonstrate to people how this works, and as well how this works with foliage and other things along with this track. Now these are knuckles or fists. In the lower left might be a little tough to see, but you have two imprints. And you can see there by the tape that they're a good 3.5 to 4 feet apart. Now that's a pretty big spread. But the morphology says how big would the fist be in a hominid? It's similar to a standard human. How big would that fist be if this gap was this and you're in a stable position where your hands are tilted 15 degrees? Well, they would be 7 to 8 inches. And these are 7 inch wide fists. We actually know the subject this would be then because we measured her and scaled her so many times. We know exactly who this is. So this is the alpha female of the group. She stands, she's been scaled using survey techniques at over a little over 10 foot. And she's just a hair crouch. So I don't mean a lot, you know, she's just down like this from it. So she has to exceed that. So we estimate her 10'6" if we want to drop some of that away. At that, her girth in photographs, and I'm not sure we have those, but anyone concerned can look up Kryder Exploration and or you cut by me, you know, I'll link you to them. I can link this on my phone. But in that photograph, you can fit two slender men in her leg. So it's not like it's somebody in a suit, because 6 foot is her elbow. Her elbow measured exactly 6 feet off the ground. And so in comparison to the 5'7" person I had down there with the survey stick doing the deal, and then we did cutouts of them equally and put them on, it just knocks your socks off. It's like, gosh, you should never swallow a hole. You know, I mean, it's that this is her brain. So getting to this is the large male that we got the feet print from over there. This is his handprint. And you can kind of notice what on the left and right, but particularly on the left here, that's really one, this is barely an imprint. This is one finger imprint. And you look at it compared to my finger, and where my hand is exactly within the boundaries of his palm. That's how my hand fits. It's 8 inches wide, and it fits exactly in the center of his palm. And his hand was 16 inches long and 15 inches wide. Now here, if they live somewhere, they're not sleeping feet print, they got kids. What do kids do in there in your living room? Talk about monkeys, man. They make monkeys look silly with the kind of antics they do, bouncing around couches off the wall or whatnot. This is basically the same thing that you can also imagine behaviorally must come from a much more tempered society than ours. Because anytime we see kids hold out somewhere they shouldn't, whether it's on their feet, hands, lip, somebody runs out there and grabs them up. Now, they seem to let them run around with a problem where they're not going to leave a lot of marks, which is also indicative of another understanding, which is we don't need to leave a lot of marks as a people or as a being or as a creature. So in this case, we had a young one that we were tracking a group, and then it was all hardbacked, gravelly riverbed. We kept losing. And all of a sudden, the soft sand bank shows up, about a foot tall over the gravelly hard stuff. And sure enough, man, it was like a soft place. If I was a kid, I'd jump right in the middle of it. And that's exactly what it looks like he did. It's like he went up there, dove down on his knees, and then stuck his hands to his side and gave a couple big paws with his knees, and then he did a no-handed hop with his knees, and then something just picked it up. There was no more marks, and there was enough room, probably about from here to the projector, right there. There was enough room with that much sand, so something that could have reached out that big and snatched that almost my size. You can see the tape there for reference. Being out of the sand, there's not a mark, and that's soft sand. You're like, this leaves a mark. He didn't float away. Mama, or big brother, or And somebody snatched him and got him off that sand. And that tells us something. And we've seen this repeated times. There's small tracks over there we have. The one we call Jasper, because his toe is so ridiculously long. It's like a finger. And there is a little scrape on the end, but still, regardless, which you can see the dashel toe with the dermal ridging is long. And so, but he had apparently run out of a thick, brambly, you know, 2 inch long Russian olive thicket, and right out into the mud, and same thing. The other prints we have that are a double print, one over the other, was a subject that took 2 steps, 1, 2, grabbed him. And then his tracks vanished, and then it turned around on the same motion and stepped right back in his former print and back on the bank. And that's that thing, it's a double sitting over each other. And it was a story. It's like, man, kids do this, it's ridiculous. So, and many animals, I mean, everything plays, kittens would go crazy, so it can't be. Again, this is a child track. It took 4.25 inches, that's one actually on the right, one below that. Then we have toddlers, what we call toddler, around 6 inches. This is actually what we call Davis when he was about a year from Maryland, because we witnessed through the audio and the inferred evidence, we can tell what they're doing. And when you find blue, small blue human looking poo, you know what that is. You know it's from an infant nursing and a lactating mother, just like a human baby, blue, green. It tells us. And then later, within so many months, we begin to see marks on the ground. And then within 6 months, they're already standing on the ground. And at least 6 months of this supposed event. And we had a number of prints from one about that age over there on the table as well. There's actually from Jasper on him. And this is another juvenile 8-inch track. The tracks, you can look how different these two tracks look. And people would say, well, they both look like a Bigfoot track because there's no arch in the one on the right and one on the left. Well, it's got a big tarsal break. So we know the foot's hyperflexible in that way. But I'll tell you right now, the foot's flexible in many ways. And they can look so much like a human print that don't even look to tell you that because it's got an arch or anything else, that it's not human. They can, their foot's as pliable as your hand. And they can put it in any position they want to. And we'll see that over and over. This is Amos again at 8.5 or 9 inches. That cast is on the track over there. And in the lower left, we see it on the sand. Now, if you look at the bottom of the foot in clay, wet clay on the right, this is what we get. And then if you look real close in the left-hand lower photo, at the top right of that photo, you'll see it's almost completely flat in sand. That's the same foot again. So these are two different subjects, similar substrate. One substrate of where they stepped in the track looks one way. The other substrate looks totally different way as far as the way it goes. So tracks vary with the living thing. That's what we need to remember. Excuse me. This is an adolescent at 10 inches long, who we frequently saw together. And we saw them with the younger individual you can see here. And again, if you look at the large toe structure in the lower print, it looks greatly exaggerated to the rest of the print. And this tells us again that this is a younger individual who's still growing, because on our table we show the toe, the great toe structure to the ratio of the rest of the foot is huge in these things when they're young. It's really big. I believe it's because it's going to have to support a very large individual. And so that's an exaggerated portion on the younger. And it remains that way until they begin to get, you know, 14, 15 inches, and then it kind of grows into the side of the foot. Here is a 17-inch track from a young adult, and he's on his own, and he's up occupying a small mountain, and no one seems to be occupying it with him. And he does things like cleans up deer carcasses, and things like that that he finds on the side of the road. The highway department pushes off and gets rid of. This is the tracks from the large female again. Now, these are 20 inches long. Sometimes they show up to be 19 if she's cupping her foot. And but you can see the bottom stick at the bottom left. What shows right there, that's those two white black sections for each foot. So that's, it shows almost 24 inch in the sand. And then above that is my boot print. And the bottom print of the sand is almost tough to pick out. Until you let your eyes back up a little bit and look at the top mark and then the bottom mark, and you realize they're identical. And that's my step and her step. And that's her scale size to me. This is the prints of the big nail. Took almost 6 years to get his print. Took 4 years to get the one from the lower left breaking through frozen stream, 4 inches wide. And you can see the stick on the ground in that photo is a 7 foot stick. So you can see how far that step was. Now the last step, the one from here to the bank, was 12 feet. But this is a 23 inch foot. The picture on the right was taken while the subject was 40 feet from it. About after maybe 4 minutes after he left it. And he was still there and he was observing me while I took that picture. And this is in a video called Waiting the Giant. And if you do look at our channel and watch that, I highly advise watching the edition that has the follow up. When we go back, we go in the next day and we look at the area and we do a forensic study of the area and collect hair and we measure all the damage and everything else that these two subjects put me through that day. So it was an hour and 45 minutes in there by myself with them in the daytime. But this is his print. It took a long time to find him. A buddy of mine, Bob, is the one that actually spotted these prints. And I call myself a tracker. I feel a little confident, but I'm pretty good. But I was standing off. Bob was 20 feet away. And he saw what's called shine. So when we look toward the sunlight, you'll notice this. If I bring it up, you'll notice it all. And you're on a gravel parking lot, on a lawn, anything else. Green lawn, great. Carpet. And you have a light behind you, you'll get what's, every time something steps, you get what's called shine. And it's because of the flattening or the alignment of anything from the angle of the sun. And it works on everything. Even the leaves, you can have, you can still see the shine. And so that's just what trackers call it. From Bob's perspective, he can see that because he's 30 feet from me. And he can see two of these big old prints. And I'm standing right over them. And I'm a tracker. And I look down, he goes, dude, you're on a track. And I look down, and I didn't see a track. It took me a second. What I saw was the two big toes. Looked like a cow footprint. There was no other line of cow prints. And I realized, oh my God, I had to back up. And I was, oh my gosh, this is a damn footprint. This is him. I mean, this is years before it's happened. And so Bob, he's like, yeah, dude. So we went on, we had to go out. Bob's a great guy, man. But we were done for that day. We didn't see more sacrifices. It's a short sequence of track that I was in. I didn't have any casting material or anything else, so I was nutty about it. So I went back the next day with another guy. And we were in there about 45 minutes. We just got past, we found those tracks. And I told him, I said, I'm going to wait and hear and see what's going on. He said, well, if we're just going to hang out, I'm just going to go ahead and take off. I don't really know why, but he did. So he bolted. And I thought, okay, whatever. So I waited another 20 minutes or so. Let's bring some. The thing's gone down a little bit. So I'm not broadcast out here. And I began to move off from that and ended up running into that big nail that next following day, just after that. I've been an hour and 3 hours. Okay, this takes us to foliage manipulation. Now, structures are a common thing everybody talks about, and there's a lot of supposition in them. And it's something that we just have to guess what made it, basically, until there's enough at least competent evidence or competent witnesses. Didn't have watched anybody assembly one. Now, messing with one's not even really enough to know because, sure, you messed with it. But what we do see is quite interesting. And some of these, we do see what appears to be purpose. Now, we don't just, this one, they're like, he's sitting in. It's quite open, but it still has a supportive structure. But it's not indicative of anything that a person would put together with cross-leaning on the bottom like that. It's just odd. People just don't usually do that. And another thing we found near it, which you can see in the lower left-hand photo, is it was a smaller one there. It was like a cage. There was a couple more in the area that were still partially up a little better, but it was on a stump, fashioned on a stump. And then they had set it up almost like it would have been like a cage, like if you'd stuff a turkey or something. It was very weird that it was small like that. Don't really know what that means. In other instances, it's pretty obvious. Being where we are, is a big thing, especially if you're traveling and some of these riverbeds don't have any cover. Often they're in the Royals like this, so there's plenty of obstruction that give you cover seats so people see you, but not from the elements. Often there's nowhere to hide from direct sound. And we watch and see where they create shelters. It's either maybe somewhere you can hang out and know you're not going to get run into or whatever, or it's somewhere on the pathway. But in this case, they drug a whole mass of branching and stuff, and they drug it over and laid it down. And we think, well, it's possible erosion, and then it laid it down in that position. But we have situations like that, and they don't bridge gaps that way, because that's not going to stay there in that position very long. That's going to get rained on, heat and cool, and that's going to drop. So it's not been there very long at this point, but it provided a really large, very nice area for shade. Now, the more common breaks and twists. This is something that not only people witness, but remember, a few times are these things done together. A few times are these things done without purpose. It's not just a pain in the water, it's breaking stuff again. Few creatures do anything without purpose. People do a lot or whatever. But we don't see that in the natural world very often. And in this case, it has to make you wonder how. Well, through years and years and years in the same group, going sometimes daily to where they're at and hanging around where they are, and then noticing what happens when they move, because they do move. And what they'll do is they'll take it, like the lower left, they'll snap new growth. Often the toughest stuff you've got, like in this case, Russian olive, again, it's unbelievably hard wood, super hard to break, really hard. And they'll break these things off, and then what they are is your marker posts. So this tells you where they are at any given time. And so when they go into a small area of the family unit and they hang out, they'll do this at the entry and exit points, or at least the entry points, the forward points, in the foliage. And they'll do them every day they're in there, there'll be one. Because you'll go in, they're in there, and they're wet, you know, hours. And then if you go in and it's very dry at all, you go in and they're not there. You see signs of them being there. But so where they're at is quite frequently remarked. And you can actually look for and time their interaction by tagging how the foliage degrades after it's broken. Because a full breakdown and drying of the leaves and things like that takes a certain amount of time. And you can get used to that, maybe track. Now the twisting here, there's an interesting thing. Did anybody notice what's behind the twist? Does anybody see it? That's a blue and white basketball. Now, if we have a family unit down there, right? And this thing right up here, that's a blue and white basketball. And this is what mom does in the edges of the zone, or in the zone, where they're occupied, and they're kind of like, it's like a, let's say, romper room, it's probably more like living room. And they'll do this type of damage. Now, another very similar type, it's most often twists. In this case, they did a snap. It's what we call rub and send post. They're manufacturing these. And when you learn to predict where their locations are based in an area of their occupation, we found five of these in a day. Because they do them in the same situations. It doesn't even matter if we found them in Utah, Michigan, New Mexico. That's a huge, broad geographic region with totally different environments. They're doing the same thing. And they often pick a type or another cedar or fibrous tree or whatever that will kind of almost survive the damage. And in this case, what they did was they'll do this and then they'll rub on them. And you'll get a thick deposition of skin cells, skin, and hair. And so we use these when we find corroborative evidence like feet print or speed scat, things like this, and they're on a travel corridor. And by over the years, we're able to tell, well, this size of footprint, this color of hair. And what we see is that apparently the large female was the one primarily doing it forever. And then we get to where George, who's a chestnut color, little orangey in the head, subject, and he started to do it after a while. This is actually one of the right, very recent photos. The one on the left is a different little cedar, and that hair and that shows you what type of foliage they're doing. So we'll have a dissimilar type of foliage behind. We'll be what apparently is out front, a little bit of foliage from a barrier. And they'll do it on that one out front, the What that means, there's a corridor there. When you go on into that, you go into the thick stuff behind those, and sometimes you can't even see how to get in. You go in, then all of a sudden it's cleared out, and you go in and it marks the tunnel. So this is, it's quick reference. If you know how to read it, you're just going to walk it. Go, there's me right here, right here. If you go through it, it takes you around mud, drop-offs, and obstacles, and it shoots you through another location. So, blinds and barriers. And I won't touch too deep on this because I mean, it's already been discussed by two people. And that is, it goes back all the way into game acquisition diet. But they'll often make blinds and barriers, and not just for hunting, but as territorial or to keep you out. And we, that's why one zone, this one here is still tree. But we've seen zones like this where there's not a single green or a stick or anything all the way up and down all the shafts of the internal trees. And then we have more than this trees carried in. Now, I say carried in because if you actually look at the picture on the right, neither one of those trees have a hole to them. There's no hole there. There's also no tree to hold the tree behind it. Or look back further behind that tree. There's no hole to that tree either. These are all carried in trees. These trees, one of them, on the lower left photo of the lower left tree that goes down, is 100 feet long. It's 31 inches thick. It's the only one I measured. It's 31 inches thick. A tree that size weighs on average 16,000 to 18,500 pounds. And they carried that in. Now, you look there, see the dirt on the ground on the right-hand picture on the left of it? You see the dirt sitting there? That's a clump of dirt that just fell there. It hasn't been snowed on. This is a 10,000-foot in the mountains during the lodge expedition. Ron Caster, the front row here, was on that expedition. That's days old. Now, as a tracker, I don't know how long that dirt takes to just fall apart. Humidity changes, sun hits it, it just crumbles out. That's days old, not hours old. That tree was put there, and it didn't fall there. Now, we talk about territory prowess. But why would you do this? Why do you do things that take immense amounts of strength for no other purpose than seemingly to show you I got immense amounts of strength? And that is the purpose, I believe. Many animals flaunt their craft. You ever been to a bar? Somebody's going to walk in and act like what? Cocky. You know where that comes from? The way a rooster acts, which is how? Well, cocky. So what we see in the same thing here. It tells you, again, about behavior. But are they doing it with their own body? They're expressing this prowess through other objects that they think other beings or creatures are going to understand that prowess, apparently. So is that communication? It certainly is communication. When we look at the lower left photo, they've seen a lot of trees. We've seen trees in the Pacific Northwest that are turned upside down and shoved into the mud. And there's a lot of controversy around that. That lower left photo right there, there's something there that's indicative of something completely different. For one, it's finesse. A lot of care to exerting a tremendous amount of force. And the reason I say that is, do you see that curvy piece of bleach to it there? That's the taproot. Something is a green tree, mind you. The boughs are still dry, the needles are still dry on the top of the branches. They haven't fallen off. Even though it's grayed out from sun, but it's within what, a season to do that. Now, what gets me is I've never seen ever a pine tree ripped out of the ground with a taproot on it. Because they snap off. They don't come out. If you can see the curve in that one, that's because it went around as a structure when it was growing, like a boulder or a rock. That means it wasn't just plugged into the dirt. Whatever it was able to pull that straight up with enough force to pull out the entire tree like a carrot. Then go carry it over there and set it there. Now on the right, you want to show where how serious we are. I mean, it's not just prowess, but it's original, it's territory. How serious are we? Where's the edge of our line? You know, and that comes to accountability at that point, because someone's trying to justify how accountable they are for keeping you out, basically. So it's like you cross this line. Isn't that what a line is? It's an agreement, contract. If you do this or do that, I'm gonna whack you. You're not gonna whatever it is. In this area, the 30 people a year have gone missing. Rock verified. He's USFS active manager and officer. He verified 37 people in 3 years. That's what they report. Now, there's a lot of people. Wouldn't you think there might be a territorial dispute? Put a big marker. These trees are 90 feet tall. They would estimate, because they're thin to their diameter, about 18 to 22 inches, about 4,500 pounds. And there's fashion to doing it. biggest one I ever seen. I never saw it. You see an apple coming through the foreground in the photo. The one the guy's plugged on. But that structure is 60 feet behind that apple. So it's hard to get the gravity in that shot. That's just how really big that is, how far you got to back up to get that to a brain. So we'll go on to defecation. Probably one of the most important factors, probably one of the most overlooked factors in all the science. This tells you more about an individual than probably any other single aspect of the individual itself. So it tells you habits. So in this case, we see piles of scat. Now, I'll say in the big picture on the right, the piles of scat are accompanied with 20-inch and 16-inch footprints. Two subjects defecated right next to each other in a riverbed. The picture on the right, on the left, again, two circles there. There's two piles of scat there. Both piles do live in a certain distance to each other on a riverbed. And in this case, there wasn't much tracking. I don't know if it makes it definitive, like the one on the right. One on the right, there was a track, there was a 20-inch track. Now, reading doesn't just tell us, do they do what they do? So I'm gonna add in that last picture that during a couple studies, in one in particular, we found 48 piles in a single day before they moved on to a new section. And there were seven individuals. We figured about 60 pounds overall of scat in a week between the little seven-member little family guys that always stay with the little group there. But we noticed they all defecate together. And one subject would defecate, I think maybe, no, not the back of this picture, but one subject would defecate 20, 30 feet from everyone else. So you have all of them drop and go together. And one's 20, 30 feet over there. So all we can usually surmise by that is either shy, right? Or he might be watching and looking while they all go. Then when they get up to progress, he goes. Now it's just supposition. We don't do that a lot, but it almost tells that story. So interpretation. This is where things get good with this species, as far as I'm concerned. So it's the contents and conditions that we find these things to get into it. And Ron asked me a question earlier about a specific dietary need that I'll go ahead and answer about the after. But I'll do that in a second after we break down something quite obvious, a story, another story told to us through evidence. When an animal defecates, it means it passed all this through its body. It means it had to be somewhere to get the stuff into its body, correct? In this case, we have Russian olive seed. We know the regions those come from, the lower regions of the riverbed and the riparian zone. And then we have pinyon pine nuts, which don't grow in those regions. Those grow, in this case, about 5 miles away, about 800 feet up the mountain. So the subject here has obviously been in those two positions within one defecation period, by the way. Also, what do we see at the top? What do all they eat? So we see grasshopper leg right next to a road bone, right next to deer fur. Well, what do we have here? What does this say? This says that the subject obviously went, this is in the riverbed. So we know he didn't go from the riverbed to the mountain, back to the riverbed, based on what we see in what we're looking at, because of distance travel, would be he came off the mountain after eating pine nuts on the way down, entered the river system, at some point or another, encountered a deer carcass or whatever, even maybe before he got there, or maybe ate part of the deer, got to the river system, most likely a grasshopper and a rodent, and then started feeding on Russian olive seed, and then deposited scat. So it tells a lot of behavior. Now, when we see, like I said, specific bird seed, and we know this guy over here is feeding black bird seed, it's all sunflower seeds or whatever it is, and this guy's got his bird seed in his deal, then we're like, sometimes it tells us maybe we should go to his house and go look for sign, because most likely it's his or someone else that's feeding that bird seed. Okay, now this takes us into vocalizations. A microphone, let's see, 403. Okay, so I might go ahead here and do something a little bit different. I might run over just a little bit. Hope you guys don't mind. And I want to play a few vocalizations and then we'll clear this up for us. And to do that, I'm going to have to swap audio if you guys know the one thing. Thank you.
So if this works on their first run, it might be so loud it reverbs and everyone screams like crazy. We'll see what happens. This is the sound of a male that we're aware of and a mountain lion, where the mountain lion interacting to the male. Here's a family. Save time. I want to show a couple of things not a lot of people have heard. We'll see how long this one is here. And then this is a tone that we pick up on some of our equipment that's a little different than what a lot of people have heard. That takes a pretty good sized animal to do that. And I'll give them one more. Yeah, and that actually shakes everything. That's distorting the mic. That's putting out so much amplitude. And this is a screaming recording. Cut my presentation a little short. Maybe I'll put that in tomorrow if you guys come back in. We're going to have to try to stick to our schedule to some degree so we can get Ken on his timeline. So I will just go through very, very quickly. Some of this I've already covered, so it's not too bad. That's that they'll move in scattered groups looking for resources. They will gather consume food while searching for other resources. They will collect and deliver food to sedentary individuals in a camp situation, because we've seen yucca delivered to the older male up on the high mountains from the valley, and he's all got missing teeth and everything, and he's not going to up and down. See, using top methods to plant animal hatch and migration times and stages. This goes from how to acquire algae, what time of year, to knowing when a moth hatching is going to occur. Search is an individual subject. So oftentimes we'll see these rogues, or we'll see these young males are out on their own, and they'll just be caught foraging for his resources. Hunting, we talked about this, it's already been discovered to some degree, use cooperative hunting techniques for small and large game. They'll funnel and direct deer in the ambush position used by use of foliage barriers, which we've seen in many, many cases. And we've also seen them use a hill slope or ravine and the brush to get everything to go down into one small section. funnel and direct your activity in the presence of vocal reports. Okay, so we've been steered through the forest with vocal reports many, many times, both inquisitively and in intimidation. So it's oftentimes, if one's going to look at you, we do this. I've trained everybody. If you hear a sound, look 180 degrees from the sound, because it's almost a distraction, so one can get a look at you and make an assessment there. Construct, utilize sound traps, locate prey in danger. They'll actually can lay branches, lay cross hatch, fill it with leaves. It's a trap. So anybody that's ever probably been military trained has probably experienced something similar to that. It's a sound trap that you can't progress down certain avenues of travel without stepping on this thing. Yet they've got enough clearance, they'll clear it. They'll step all the way over and jump all the way over. Build rodent small game traps, especially the nesting sites. We've seen where stumps have been moved, evidence left behind because none of them did it. And they'll take, either the rodent or them, takes small grass and puts in there because stumps not hooked to the ground. And they'll stuff a bunch of stuff under it in a little open area. And it's interesting because the area is almost always a little open, like as if you want to try to catch something. And then these stumps will often be flipped over and then we'll go back and they'll put back into position. So it tells me that something may be thinking enough to make a track for a small rope. Occupation. Utilize an area about 2 square miles for 5 to 7 day periods of family group and then move again. Utilize range 100 square miles as a family group overall. Change area as impact grows, resource diminishes to non-adjacent areas. That means they don't normally just go next door. They go down here away. So they go 5 miles down the river, 2 miles down the river, or wherever the next resource that has been depleted or the game hasn't been grown. Overall average range due to seasonal weather and game migration. Utilize high rated areas, retreat, solitary, and group large males. So we've often seen what apparently is just groups of large males in the highest, most remote, most rugged areas. And what I believe is it's a lot like native colonies have done for a long time. A lot of times the old males just had enough of everything and they just want to go hang out with what they do. And often they barely. And they'll have a burst and then as soon as they'll come down to the family units, hang out for a while, kill a bunch of dogs, chase people off, intimidate people, and then they're back to the mountains again. And it's like, it's almost like it's short to come home because they might stay about 6 weeks. Or 2 months or whatever before they come back in again, and it's like a 2 or 3 day thing. And I think it's like, man, I'm not doing this. I'm going back to the guy. Grouping, kind of the same thing we kind of discussed. Family unit 7+ subjects, females lead, and male mostly absent. Now when the male comes around, you can absolutely tell it's his world. Kids act different, mom acts different, everybody acts different. For large subgroups, young to hunt, or for the unit, often cause trouble. This is already been covered as well. You know what started some of the biggest Native American massacres in history? Were 14 to 16 year old going and doing their thing, man, feeling the ropes like we do today. And this apparently is the same thing that would occur because then often it would bring all this havoc back on the tribe. It's really a form of innocence and growth. So we should expect this in any higher thinking. Animals are gonna be a little bit cocky, capturing my way, all kinds of stuff that way. And it tends to be about that age to where when you start feeling your oats a little bit, yeah, I can go in the dark, I can scare no more. I'm gonna go get me a goat, which Ron brought to me, not to push too long, a goat kill that we did where there was an experienced individual and inexperienced individual. Once we've named George, your name is just for the facts, so we have a reference. And one apparently could do, lay a goat down, twist its neck, do it absolutely silent, poke the jugular, poke the carotid artery, drain them of all their blood, wouldn't be nothing left but mouth marks and saliva all over them and twisted up like a damn sock. Apparently laying them down alive. And then one didn't quite make it that way. The smaller individual had to bite one through the skull. But it tells us a lot about who's doing things. We've never seen an older one do anything like that. On the Navajo Reds out there, they ripped the horse in half and some other stuff that was pretty big and brutal, but those are different mad males upset with the people. Form smaller subgroups, two older subject, hunt, game, and raid. Males often move a few miles away alone with young. Mature, large males will often retreat to the highest, rugged, most dense areas together. So man versus ape, this is going to be pretty quick. This, our source here is not just some supposition or an idea or the internet. This comes from the modern anthropological curriculum for today's studies and today's degrees. And thanks to my fiance, Tara, for me to have these resources and up-to-date, the latest up-to-date materials we've got today. And this is what they say.
Use the microphone. Talk a little slower.
I've got to.
Talk slower. It's over on the side.
Okay.
Come out where we can see your face.
I have a hard time running my rig here. That's what I have to deal with. Oh, my face is much harder to see anyway, trust me. Okay, so like I said, our sources through the lens of anthropology, the modern curriculum on anthropological sciences. And this is what they had to say. They said, believers should be aware that if they do sight a Bigfoot, they should probably leave it alone. It probably isn't a large human-like ape. If it exists, it's probably a human who wants to be left alone. And nobody should do it harm. Recall that if a primate is bipedal, as Bigfoot is typically reported to be, is classified as human. Now, this is the scientific viewpoint. So I want to bring something up real quick in closure. There are scientists out there telling you this could be, it even could be, an ape. There's never been a bipedal ape. There never will be a bipedal ape because science sees a bipedal primate as human. Remember that all the ancient forms you see, Homo florensis, the Hobbit, all these things, no matter what size they were, Denisovan, 9-10-foot tall, or Hobbit 3-foot, that doesn't matter. They're all humans. Lucy, the oldest, anything bipedal is a primate, is classified as human. So the moment that a true scientist who's going to return to a set standard, you have to have some set standard. That standard is that science sees any bipedal primate as human. That's an interesting thing here because people love to debate. There's what they call the apers, and there's what they call the loons, what they call whatever, but it's not up to that. Here's the classification. So go outside that, and you just have to admit you're going outside the science, scientific understanding of the species. Now you might have your own understanding. It might be better than science. It's going to revise science, but that's not the way they're looked at, so they shouldn't be discussed that way. Also, every single thing we know about them is indicative of a people with some form of culture, and we understand how birds have a culture. I mean, everything does kind of, but that's not what we're talking here. Through what I've shown you, there's even demonstrating a lot different forms of thought. What you do is put that all into one area. And I said to many people, all this is fingers on a hand. But there's a core, there's a palm in the middle, there's a core to all that's self-evident. And when we look at this terminology, we can't argue with what their own terminology is. So it should give us some clarification, regardless of what our theory might be, into at least if it's an ape, then it's something that's not anything like any other ape that's ever existed that we know of in the natural order. But that's going out on a farther limb than it is to say that there's some form of either hybridized or relic hominid running around. I didn't say hominid. I said hominid. Because a human can be a hominid, but they cannot be a hominid. Some reason why computer's not progressing. Okay, so this is going to bring us almost to close here. Sorry for going over so long. So as I said, I was a member of the Oxford Museum Collateral Hominid Project. This is for your benefit as much as it's for mine. I'm not trying to create controversy. I'm tired of there being misunderstanding or no understanding at all. I'm tired of that no understanding at all being served an agenda. The things we've seen occur can happen on accident. This sample in particular is the sample that I've mentioned to many people that they held the entire Oxford study 2 months in advance to get. But that sample is curated. They made a mistake. They gave it a sample number. They curated the sample that they told the Associated Press that all samples were tested. My letter said we never tested this one. After they waited 2 months to get it, literally, they held it globally. The whole world waited for this thing to come out. 2 months for this sample. They tell me it's been curated in the museum of zoology of Lausanne, Switzerland for future study. Okay, that's, we all know what that is. when they tell you a lot, when they tell you that, that they found bear hair, the DNA tested, why did DNA taste bear hair? Why did you? All this should have been qualified before they were testing it. Why did they test Fox? Why did they test anything like that? Why did they say they did that? The whole point was to test for unknowns. Test unknowns. We're going to DNA test whatever's unknown. We get two samples. One came back unknown. We couldn't get any DNA. Cool. Let's have a sample. Get you another one. Set that in. The whole study gets released. Everything's published. They told the AP Brian Sykes public directly. We tested all. Nothing was blah, blah, blah. No, they didn't. And there's your sample number if anybody wants it. You're welcome to call the museum of zoology and was there. Say, hey, where the hell is that sample at? Why wasn't it involved in the study? Let's get that thing back out. But the other one that people aren't going to like a whole lot is this one. People might need to ask about this one, too. The reason we don't have much from the University of New Mexico study, and also the reason that the executive director of the university was brought up, they were going to bring him on charges of fraud for defrauding the American public out of tax money for the year-long fictitious study that we defrauded and never did. And their justification, where's all the evidence? Where's your material you gave? Where's the physicality behind all this money you spent with the university? Which was discretionary funds, could have been gone deep. But in this case, we give it to Dr. Melder. He disappears. He won't answer the phone for a full year for the executive director. So we finally got a hold of him through means and offered to pay him to speak at college and present his normal presentation during our two-day scientific presentation on the year-long study. Which he did. He showed up to do that, which he's going to pay for. And at a meal in the evening, he was asked by the executive director, hey, man, we did something. And he asked him, where's the DNA? Where's all the evidence? We didn't just give a little evidence. We give a lot. And he says, oh, well, he just shrugged his shoulders like this. And yeah, he progressed a little. And he said, well, I kind of lost it. And I asked him, I said, where's the chain of custody? Did we need to lost? You can't lose scientific evidence. Now, we had instructed him because of my previous experience with Brian Sykes and the Oxford study. We had told him, anywhere you're not sending this material, it's to Brian Sykes or anywhere overseas. This is to remain domestic. We want American universities and have to work on this 100%. No problem. So what did I say? I said, where? Where's the chain of custody? What did you do with it? He told me, I gave it to Brian Sykes. Out of all that, this is not one error. This is a tremendous amount of work that resulted in a state senator proposing law in Mexico to stop any funding of all mythological creatures because we didn't have the DNA and the data and the materials that were sent overseas. So I'll just leave it right there. Now,
and my
Democrats. Oh, did you never? Maybe by people out here, maybe bags of cash. I don't know what goes on. Albert, I'm going to close with a quote by Albert Einstein. It says, the barest thing we can experience is the mysterious. It is the fundamental emotion which stands in the cradle of true art and science. And with that, thank you. I conclude. Thank you.
Okay, folks, we're going to have a little change of schedule here. Our VIP dinner is not going to happen. Cater is a no-show. So in about 15 minutes, we're going to go ahead and roll with Ken Gerhardt, and that way you folks can wrap this thing up for today. What we'll do right now, though, we have one more drawing for a door prize this evening. So.